2007 Exo Terra expedition explored the vast jungles of Gabon. Gabon emanates the mood of equatorial Africa in its wild state. Frozen in time, the only remaining example how tropical Africa once was. Gabon is bordered to the west by the Atlantic Ocean, to the north by Equatorial Guinea and Cameroon, and to the east and south by the Congo. The 800-kilometer sandy coastal strip is a series of palm-fringed bays, lagoons and estuaries. The lush tropical vegetation, which covers about 82% of the interior, gives way in parts to savanna. Gabon is one of the least explored countries in Africa. The main research area of this expedition was Luango, situated in southwestern Gabon. This area alone is home to 37 species of reptile. 3 crocodilians, 8 chameleons, 14 lacertilians, and 12 ophidians, distributed in 30 genera recorded so far. Due to the nature of the area, we expected that more species could be present, some even unknown to science. The goal of this expedition was to expand the knowledge of the herpetofauna of this unique piece of primal Africa. The Exo Terra team members flew from Paris to Libreville, the capital of Gabon, where the plane touched down in the late afternoon. Immediately upon arrival, the team started preparing for the upcoming 3 weeks away from civilization. The next morning, a local market was visited in the suburbs of Libreville. Traders from all over Gabon and even from neighboring countries come here to sell their produce, goods and catch. One stand in particular catches the Exo Terra team's eyes. This stand sells animals and animal parts used in local medicine. It was loaded with chimp heads, gorilla hands, skulls, animal skins, hippo feet, parrots, eagle claws and baskets of dried lizards, chameleons and snakes. In another part of town, 3 recently skinned leopard skins were found drying openly on the street. Unfortunately, poaching is still everyday business in this part of Africa. That also proved the local restaurant where porcupine, python, crocodile and other bush meat could be ordered. Animal parts can be found everywhere, even in the arts and craft market, where they are used in masks and other African art pieces. Right on the beach, near the hotel, some reptiles and amphibians could be photographed. The rock agama, or agama agama, was the most common one. Especially the males, with their yellow-orange heads and tails, were a striking appearance. Most of the forests around Libreville have disappeared, except for a small patch north of the capital. The team decided to explore this small patch, penetrating as deep as possible using a logging road. Besides some insects, invertebrates and some frogs, not many animals were found during this short visit. On the very bad road back out of the forest, the team spotted some bottles with tadpoles outside a hut near the logging road. Closer examination revealed it to be small catfish. The team now was ready for the real challenge and headed via Port Gentil, the main port of Gabon, to Luango. From Port-Gentil, Luengo can only be reached with a small six-seater airplane. The landing strip in Luengo is nothing more than a flat part of the savannah, and the plane literally landed between the buffaloes and elephants. After being picked up by the local expedition staff near the Atlantic Ocean, the night was spent in a small lodge near one of the many deep lagoons. Early the next morning, the expedition headed towards Akaka by boat. Akaka can only be reached by boat, crossing the length of the Iguela Lagoon before traveling up the Rembo Nwange River. This area captures the essence of coastal Gabon. Vast waterscapes, remoteness, and the constant forest backdrop. Bird life along the rivers is prolific and varies from tiny kingfishers to giant pelicans. Close to the camp, one of the three crocodile species was spotted, the slender snout crocodile or Crocodilus cataphractus. This rare crocodile was basking on a branch in the morning sun. The rivers and its shores were full of life, including the elusive forest elephant. Right at the camp, a pair of pied kingfishers was hunting. The team quickly set up camp and dropped their gear to explore the forest around Akaka. It did not take long before they spotted a green tree snake, Dipsadoboa duchesni. Dipsadoboa duchesni is a slightly venomous snake that feeds on frogs, lizards and chameleons. Heavy rains forced the team to go back to base camp in order to protect camera and photo equipment. It also forced the team to have some rest, something they otherwise would have skipped. As soon as the worst rains were over, some team members could not wait to explore the area again. The bravest explored the surrounding waters by canoe, knowing that crocodiles and hippos are certainly present or that they might run into a crossing elephant. Luckily, there were no encounters with big game, and the only reptile that was spotted was a forest hingeback tortoise, Kinixis erosa. Team member Roland Zobel, in the meantime, explored the tiny life below water. Gabon is known for its many endemic species and varieties of killifish. Every river system has its own variety, and the more complex the system, the more species it supports. Luengo's river, swamp and lake network is so vast that it can only be explored by boat. The remotest corners can only be reached by shallow speedboats from our campsite in Akaka. The team spotted a deserted village deep in the Luengo jungles, now inhabited by a large group of red-capped mangabey monkeys. These abandoned houses make great shelters for various reptiles and amphibians. A forest cobra was found hunting for prey in a bush near one of the ruins. It was a young cobra of about 1 meter, but still dangerous enough and capable of killing a human. Not a comfortable situation with the closest antivenin hours away. On an old tree, a Hemidactylus fasciatus was found basking near its hideout. This larger gecko is probably the most conspicuous night gecko of Western Africa. The smaller Hemidactylus richardsoni is somewhat smaller and less colorful, but both geckos of the same genus share the same habitat. Along a game track that led into the forest, a small green frog was discovered belonging to the Hipparolidae. This unknown frog was well photographed and documented to ease the determination afterwards. This forest appeared to be very rich in amphibian biodiversity. Many other Hipparolids were photographed and documented. Reptiles were not so common in this swampy forest, except for the occasional skink. Before heading back to the boat, the team found the chimpanzee skeleton. It was collected and handed over to British researchers who we met near the Luengo base camp. Near the boat, an agama-agama was found basking on a dead tree trunk. Not many records exist of this species in the wetlands. It was the height of the rainy season, and many forest areas were flooded. Many of the animals moved to higher grounds, deeper in the forest, what made it not so easy to spot any wildlife from the river. Sometimes elephants crossed the river right in front of the boat. Suddenly, an ornate monitor was spotted crossing the river. Varanus ornatus is found in lowland tropical forest along near permanent water in Western and Central Africa. This is thus the ideal habitat for this species. It was first described as a subspecies of the Nile monitor, but later raised into a species rank. One difference which distinguishes this species from Varanus niloticus is the wider head. In the wild, the ornate monitor feeds mainly on insects, crabs, centipedes, and small rodents. A smaller specimen was captured and documented. Capturing a monitor is not an easy task, and not without danger, as team member Loni McCaskill found out. The dwarf crocodile, Osteolaemus tetraspis, is another inhabitant of these wetlands. These are solitary crocodiles that reach about 1.5 meters. They feed on smaller vertebrates, larger invertebrates, and crustaceans. Although mainly nocturnal, some were captured and documented during daytime. All animals were later released at the location of capture. The team headed back to camp since the next day an early departure from Akaka to Luango base camp was scheduled. Loni did his laundry on the boat to appear clean and crisp on team members Guy Van Hagen's birthday that was celebrated that evening. The cook overclassed himself again, preparing an excellent meal on an old rim. That morning, the team rose early to prepare for a long boat trip back to the base camp. On the way back, a small unknown snake was found crossing the river. The slender snout crocodile, Crocodilus cataphractus, was found basking at the same spot where the team found it on the way in. It was late afternoon when the team reached the Luango base camp again. At dusk, the Igela lagoon was searched for crocodiles and hippos for the last time. In the morning, we packed 2 large Land Rovers with all our gear, food and water to spend the next few days in Tassie. Earlier that morning, the local crew left to set up camp and inspect the platform. The Tassie area is a mosaic of savannah, forest, swamp and small coastal lagoons, all in proximity to an endless stretch of beach. Getting there is a scenic 2-hour drive through the wet savannah from Luango Base Camp. Lying out in the savannah, Tassie Camp spans an ancient beach ridge catching the ocean's breeze and giving it an elevated 360 degrees view of the surrounding landscape. The tents are set up on platforms, shaded with palm thatch and spread over a distance of 600 meters along the ridge. The main platform is sheltered by a big fig tree. Soon after arrival, Roland Zobel investigates the nearby pools and small streams for fish and tadpoles. Emmanuel Van Hagen and Brian Rasmussen searched the forest edges and savannah for basking snakes and lizards. The continuous sound of the pounding surf in the background attracted the team towards the nearby beach. Emerging from the last bushes separating the savannah and the Atlantic Ocean, the sight was breathtaking. This must be one of the most unspoiled beaches in the world. Elephant families were grazing and wandering along the endless-looking beach. As soon as they spotted humans, they fled immediately in the fringing bushes to bring their babies into safety. To avoid close elephant encounters, the team walked the beach southwards to reach the camp by another inland trail. These trails are made by elephants, hippos and buffaloes that frequent the beaches. An elephant blocked this trail as well, and the team had to wait for it to leave. It was a relatively small female elephant that followed us from a distance all the way to the camp that was set up about 1 kilometer from the beach. Even at night, she was still wandering around the campsite. At about 3 a.m., the team was woken up by loud screams from one of the team members. It was Klaus Reimuller. His tent was just being attacked by the female elephant. Klaus spent the rest of the night in Emmanuel's tent, and only in the morning the damage that the elephant had caused became clear. Not only was Klaus' tent entirely destroyed, but the elephant also had destroyed the research platform. It was too dangerous to stay here another night, and the team was forced back to the base camp. On the way back, they stopped briefly at a research station from the Max Planck Institute, where they undertake a great ape habituation and research project. The research team aims at habituating 2 groups of gorillas and 1 group of chimps to human presence. This allows researchers to gather data on all aspects of their behavior and ecology. The next day, the Exo Terra expedition headed for Ivindo by the same aircraft that got them to Luango. Ivindo National Park is called the crossroads of ecosystems and is one of the most important sites in Central Africa for biodiversity conservation. The team stayed here at the research station of the WCS near Langue Bay, a natural clearing in the vast primary rainforest. This clearing was discovered by Mike Fay during the Mega Transect expedition. Since 2001, a research camp has been established in the proximity of Langue Bay to monitor large mammal activity. No studies on the herpetofauna had been conducted, which made it an interesting research area for the Exo Terra expedition. Langue Bay is one of the remotest camps in Gabon. After a 3-hour flight and 3 hours by 4x4, we reached the border of the Ivindo National Park. It took the team another 5 hours through the dense jungles, up some steep hills and packed with all the gear to finally reach the research station. Upon arrival, an African civet foraged through the camp. The African civet is an omnivorous generalist, feeding on small vertebrates, invertebrates, eggs, carrion and vegetable matter. It is capable of taking on poisonous animals, such as millipedes, scorpions and snakes. It forages by itself, and is mostly a solitary animal that avoids the presence of other of its kind. The next morning, a good breakfast helped to recover from the tough journey the day before. Immediately after, the Exo Terra team explored the area around Langue Bay in search for reptiles and amphibians. Along the path to the forest clearance, several odd-shaped termite hills rose up to 1 meter above the forest floor. The clearance itself was spectacular. Elephants, red river hawks, sitatungas, buffaloes and even gorillas were present. Langue Bay was probably created by elephants by digging in the soil for minerals. After a short rest while observing the incredible amount of large wildlife, the team continued their search for the cold-blooded members of the area's biodiversity. Emmanuel van Hagen spotted a small day gecko close to the ground on a liana. It appeared to be a member of the genus Lagoons, and since there were no records of this genus in this part of Gabon, it had to be a new species. Later determination indeed confirmed it to be a new species. This was the second discovery of new reptile species during an Exo Terra expedition. On the other hand, the reptile and amphibian diversity in this area was very poor, although insects were abundant. The only other lizard found in the park that was easy to determine was Varanus ornatus. Monitors are usually seen in the vicinity of water, but this specimen was observed high in the trees. After hours of searching, the team found an unknown skink basking on a tree trunk. But the attention was soon drawn to a giant scorpion, Pandinus dictator. Pandinus dictator is closely related to the common giant scorpion, Pandinus imperator, but has subtle differences in the carapace. This giant scorpion is actually harmless. The sting is not more dangerous than that of a wasp. Scorpions with big pincers are generally harmless. The smaller the pincers, the more dangerous. The other scorpion found in the forest was Babysaurus butneri, a nocturnal species. This species is highly toxic. The small pincers are proof of that. Scorpions can easily be spotted at night with ultraviolet light, since they are highly reflective in this wavelength of light. An unknown frog of the family Hyperolidae was the last creature to be found. Although very few reptiles and amphibians were found in the Ivindo area, the team was extremely satisfied with the discovery of another reptile species unknown to science. The expedition now headed back to Libreville, first by car and then with a Trans-Gabon Express, a train that goes from Franceville in the southeast to Libreville in the northwest. There was one more area north of Libreville that was scheduled to explore, a small remaining primary forest patch near Cap Esterias. During this short visit, we found the recently described Hemidactylus candemtohami, a small night gecko. This gecko was only described in 2002 by Aaron Bauer and Olivier Powells, and was only known from the higher regions in Gabon and Equatorial Guinea. Besides some frogs, not many other species were found, and the team returned back to Libreville. Satisfied but tired, the team members relaxed at the shores of the Atlantic Ocean and looked back at another successful Exo Terra expedition.